In our last topic, we covered water resources. Among other things, we discussed the properties of water, the importance of water, the water cycle, groundwater, our local water resources, and water quantity issues, too much or too little of water. This week, we will add to our knowledge of water by addressing water quality. The previous edition of our textbook dealt with the water quality in Chesapeake Bay. Just looking at the opening photo, it is pretty easy to imagine that this water body was polluted. Imagine all the oils, etc., running off the roads. How would that affect the aquatic ecosystem? Can you imagine swimming or fishing here? Yuck! Locally, here in the San Francisco Bay Area, I can't think of any location that resembles this photo. However, where does our road runoff go? It generally goes to local streams and wetland areas. Most communities in our area do not formally treat stormwater. Though we will see that there are ways that we can manage stormwater that will result in less water pollution. The current edition of our textbook looks at water pollution in the Gulf of Mexico, highlighting eutrophication and also the fact that the pollution sources are actually located hundreds or even thousands of miles away. Interesting. In this week's lesson, we'll review point and non-point source pollution, and then we'll look at 7 common types of water pollution and why a watershed approach is the best way to address pollution concerns. Then we'll identify ways that we can all work to improve water quality, and we'll also discuss wastewater treatment and drinking water purification. Finally, we'll look at our 2 most important water laws. Okay, so let's get started. First, we need to define what we mean by water pollution. Here's your book definition. It's pretty general. Water pollution is the addition of anything that might degrade the quality of water. Pretty good, but pretty general definition. My favorite definition is this one. Any addition to water that threatens the health, survival, or activities of humans or other living organisms. I like this definition because it states clearly that pollution doesn't necessarily have to be something that affects humans. Also, the pollution might be something other than chemicals or disease-causing organisms. For example, sediment can be pollution, as can excess heat. Okay, so we know what water pollution is in general. Next, let's identify the common types of water pollution. For our discussion, I've chosen to divide water pollution up into 7 different categories. Pause the video and read through these carefully. At the end of this week, you should be able to list the 7 types of water pollution. Additionally, for each type of pollution, you should be able to do the following. You should be able to define what it means, give specific examples, identify several important sources, and note if they are point sources or non-point sources, and identify and discuss the negative impacts of this pollution. Additionally, you'll want to be able to discuss what can be done to decrease this pollution, or to at least decrease the impacts of this pollution. We will cover some of the types listed here in more detail than others. If you need more information, I encourage you to use the United States Environmental Protection Agency website at www.epa.gov. As the name implies, the Environmental Protection Agency is the federal agency responsible for environmental research, monitoring, standard setting, and enforcement. Not surprisingly, it was established in 1970. Remember that the 1970s was the decade of the environment, when many of our important environmental laws were enacted. Another important note is that the EPA, like many federal programs, has experienced fairly continuous budget cuts over the last 10 to 20 years. Thus, their ability to do important monitoring and/or enforcement has been severely diminished. Not a pleasant thought. Before we get deep into our discussion on the types of pollution and their impacts, let's briefly review a concept we covered earlier in the course, point and non-point source pollution. Back in week 1, we introduced pollution, and we noted pollutants could be anthropogenic or natural, degradable or non-degradable, from local sources or from distant sources, and we also noted that sources could be point source or non-point sources. We identified point source as single identifiable sources. Examples include effluent pipes at wastewater treatment plants, effluent pipes at industry, or very large feedlots and waste lagoons. In contrast, non-point sources generally involve many diffuse sources. These sources are more difficult to pinpoint. Sometimes they even move. Often, they involve runoff from a large area or region. Examples include runoff from roads or runoff from agricultural fields or lawns. Cars are also a great example of non-point source pollution, both for air pollution and water pollution. There are many, many cars out there, and they're spread out all over, and they're even moving. Which is easier to deal with, do you think, point source or non-point source pollution, and why? Early environmental legislation dealt almost exclusively with point source. But now our environmental laws like the Clean Water Act and the Clean Air Act have been amended to deal also with non-point source pollution. Okay, so within any given watershed, you're likely to find both point source and non-point source pollution for one or more of the seven different types of pollution that we're going to cover. We're next going to go through those seven types of pollution. And for each, remember that you're supposed to be able to define what each means, give specific examples, identify several important sources, ideally both point sources and non-point sources, and also discuss the negative impacts of that pollution. And then lastly, come up with ideas to lessen that pollution or the impacts of that pollution. Okay, so there's five things you're looking to do for each of these types of pollution. Our first type of water pollution was disease-causing organisms. Disease-causing organisms can be bacteria, protozoa, viruses, or worms. Can you name specific organisms and/or specific waterborne diseases? Also, what are the sources for this type of pollution? In many cases, it is human feces or the feces of other animals. Can you identify specific point source and specific non-point sources for fecal contamination? The impacts of this type of pollution is quite clear. It causes disease. But next, what sort of things can you do to lessen this type of pollution or lessen the impacts of this pollution? Before you move on, make sure you've answered those five questions. Define the type of pollution, give examples, give sources, both point and non-point sources, state the problems associated with this type of pollution, and note some positive steps we can take. Taking good notes now will be helpful as you approach your future exams. All right, our second type of water pollution is plant and algae nutrients. Generally, the nutrients involved are nitrogen and or phosphorus, as these are often the limiting nutrients in aquatic ecosystems. Reviewing, you'll remember that a limiting nutrient is the one nutrient that is lacking and thus limits growth. When the nutrient is provided, growth resumes. In the case of aquatic ecosystems, nitrogen and phosphorus additions can cause massive algae blooms. Notably, this is why detergents are now marked as phosphate-free, to limit nutrient pollution. So where do these excessive nutrients come from? Commonly from human waste and animal waste, plant residues, fertilizer runoff, even atmospheric deposition of airborne nitrogen pollution from cars. Can you think of several point source and several non-point sources for nutrient pollution? Stop the video if you need to get some good notes written down. Next, what's the big deal? What's the problem with nutrients? What are the impacts of nutrient pollution? Well, there's many adverse effects. For starters, many people find the algae blooms unsightly and smelly. But more importantly, entire ecosystems are altered by the massive increase in plant and algae and the massive decline in oxygen levels. This process is called eutrophication. When we describe lakes, they are often labeled as oligotrophic, nutrient-poor, or eutrophic, nutrient-rich. An oligotrophic lake is often in areas with rocky substrate and very few nutrient sources. Because there are few nutrients, algae levels are low, and the water is often very, very clear. Many of the lakes in the Sierra Nevada are oligotrophic, including the beautiful and very clear Lake Tahoe. The photo shown here shows Crater Lake in Oregon. Note the general characteristics of oligotrophic lakes shown on the diagram on the right. Pause the video and study these characteristics. When lakes undergo eutrophication, it means nutrients are added. It can happen slowly over time naturally, or it can happen quite quickly due to nutrient pollution. In California, many lakes are experiencing anthropogenic eutrophication. Notably, Lake Tahoe, known for its clean, clear water, is at risk from nutrients from lawn runoff, septic systems, and wastewater treatment plants. So how does this occur? Imagine a lake like Lake Tahoe going from the pristine-looking lake in the previous slide to the algae-filled, oxygen-poor lake shown here. As noted previously, excess nutrients cause dramatic increases in plant and algae populations. The algae physically covers the top portions of the water, effectively blocking sunlight from penetrating deeper into the water column. Lower-dwelling plant populations decline or die off completely due to lack of sunlight. And the oxygen levels in the water are depleted because of this decline in photosynthesis. Remember that a waste product of photosynthesis is oxygen. Additionally, and importantly, as the huge masses of algae die, decomposers in the water column and on the lake floor decompose the material, and since they use oxygen, they deplete oxygen levels even further. In fact, oxygen levels can decline to such low levels that the water is not suitable for most life forms. It essentially becomes a dead zone. A famous dead zone, and the one that your book profiles, is the one that exists in the Gulf of Mexico. This dead zone varies in size from year to year, but recent measurements in the summer of 2013 depicted it as over 5,800 square miles in size. Wow! A huge region that is basically devoid of life. No fish, no shellfish, nothing, due to human-caused nutrient pollution. Obviously, this also has a huge impact on the fishing industry of the Gulf Coast states. I encourage you to look further into the Gulf of Mexico Dead Zone on the Environmental Protection Agency website, shown here. Here's the actual site. Check out the map again and notice that it shows the approximate location of the dead zone, as well as the area of land that makes up the Mississippi River watershed. Nutrient pollution from anywhere in this area will eventually lead down into the Gulf of Mexico. Thus, lawn runoff and agricultural runoff in Iowa or Minnesota or Kansas or South Dakota can and will impact the fishing industry in the Gulf. If you're interested in learning more, check out the clever documentary Big River. It's created by the same young film team that made the exceptionally interesting and amusing award-winning documentary about corn in the United States, King Corn. I recommend both.